So today is going to be a really good one. Today we're going to finally get to tackle that challenge of Lockfiles, and I'm super excited for this. So I want to set a really clear goal and objective for what we're trying to do. And I want us to answer the question, has Conan 2.0 finally fixed Lockfiles? Now, this might seem like a bad question, but how are you going to possibly answer that in some subjective matter? Well, I want to set the criteria and the goal for us to judge our README. So flipping over to this, we can see we have a lot of instructions already for how to use the project, how to work with Conan, CMake, and Lockfiles. And those Lockfiles are pretty pesky. So there's a lot of mentions of Lockfiles. And the more we look, the more questions you get. And at the end of this, I want us to look at our README and see the changes we made. And I want us to be able to answer the question, is this actually easier? Is this better for users, for developers? And I'd really love to hear from you. So if you think at the end of this that this is actually better, drop another video a like. If you have some deeper thoughts on the matter, feel free to leave comments and questions. You guys can reach out to me on social media. And we're gonna dive right in. But before we do that, we actually have some housekeeping to attend to. So, one of the questions I got asked quite a bit was, what is the migration strategy that we're going for? So, generally speaking, what you want to be looking for is you want to be getting onto the latest Conan 1.x standards and best practices. You want to be using those new generators. And you want to reach a point where you get to having a recipe that is compatible both 1.x and 2.0. And we just finished doing that in the last few episodes. And that last step that we're going to look for is we have to build our Conan 2.0 pipeline. And that's what we're going to start today with working on Lockfiles. So, with that out of the way, you guys had some really great questions and suggestions. And I'm super ecstatic. So, first off, we have Paul Harris reached out on Slack and asked, why did you use the self-source folder? So, if we flip over to VS Code, the line he was asking us about is this one right here. He wants to know why I picked to use for our source location to copy our and build our package, I picked the source folder. Now, my reasoning for this is because this is what I like to call an inline recipe, where the recipe is in line with the rest of the code. The source of truth is the source folder. I don't want the build folder because I know I'm generating and manipulating artifacts. We saw that before when we were looking at our package contents. There was a lot of extra repeated files. And for that reason, I want us to only use the source folder. It would be totally valid to swap this out for the build folder. Right? And I think in most cases, especially the out-of-source recipe, this is probably more or less what you want. And you can see here, we already did this for using our user database. And this is a really good question. We're going to leave it as source folder, and we're going to come back to this. Our second question came from Stella Smith on Discord, the hashtag include Discord. And she wanted to know why we didn't use the CMake build helper for package. Again, in our package folder. I think you guys kind of picked up on the lack of project requirements and not really knowing what we were doing. But we could have done, in place of this, cmake.install. And this was Stella's suggestion. And this was really a great suggestion. And the reason we didn't do this is because we don't actually have an install method. So nowhere in our CMake do we actually call install to install our targets. And I think this is a really excellent idea. And I think we're probably going to look forward to doing this in a future episode. So hit that subscribe button. Now, with these out of the way, we need to talk about why Lockfiles are important. And the reason they posed such a challenge was because of their format. So if we take a look at our beautiful diagram, this was presented at CppCon 2022 by Diego, talking about the new features coming in 2.0. The way it worked in Conan 1.x was that each recipe went down to different binaries. And the lock files in Conan 1.x were on the binary graph model. And that meant each lock file was specific to your settings. And you can see in this slide we were presenting, this could be whether it's shared equals true or false for your options, whether it's Windows, Linux, this here is Mac OS, depending on the architecture, if you're doing M1 or not. So the lock files in Conan 1.x were not portable to different files. Now, the way to get around this, we go back to our user management, is Conan had something called base lock files, which is this here. And what this did was it dropped all the information about settings. So you could use the same base lock file for each one. However, this still had a drawback that if your graph was different, for instance, on Linux, you need to pull in different system packages for building Qt or Boost. This did not work for you. You were still limited by matching each of the nodes in the graph. And you could see the nodes were numbered. So you had to have a graph where this was exactly what was being passed in. And this limitation really made it difficult. So if we go ahead and take a look at VS Code and grab a terminal, let's make a new lock file for the first time, right? So if we do Conan lock create, and we're gonna pass in our path. We don't need the update because we're creating one for the first time. You can see off on the side, we don't actually have any conan.lock files. When we run this, we'll be able to pull in all of those and see our new lock file for the first time. So it looks way different. And the reason we're going from this to this is because we want to be able to have a simple list of references. And you notice these references, these don't include any of the package information. This is only the name, version, and recipe revision, which are automatically on by default. In our old one, because we had it enabled in our comp, it was here, but this wasn't always the case. And the goal here is this is going to allow us to use version ranges in our Conan file. So if we go to this guy, what we can do is we can add in our version requirements. So for Rustinio, I know there's been updates to this, right? And we can say we want greater than what we've already been using while being less than 0.7.0. So everything within the same minor, I want to accept. Now we can do the same thing for speed log as well. And we're going to add a version range for this. And we're going to say everything less than 2. O.O. I like to keep them the same on both sides just so that it's easier for my brain to recognize. Now, if we go and grab our terminal and rerun our Conan install. Oops. This is the exact same command we were running last time. And on this, we'll get to actually see Conan using that lock file. So the default here, the conan.lock, will automatically get picked up and detected on our Conan install and Conan create. And you can see that here. It says using lock file. And it spews it out and tells us. And it picked the exact same versions that we had already been using, which is fantastic. Now, if we want to update our lock file, we very much can, and we're going to do that here. We're going to run our Conan install. We're going to say our lock file is going to be disabled. The reason I'm doing this is because I want to be able to generate a new one. And I want that to be specific to what we're doing. And what I want for the purpose of this demo is I'm going to add the new here. You don't need to do this if you want to update your lock files, but because I want to show you the difference, I'm going to do it this way. So you can see this is running, and this isn't using our lock file, and you can see it's picking up the new requirements. You can see Rustinio version ranges and Speedlog version ranges flicking by. And I'm going to let this download and I will pick right back up. So now that we have all of our new packages, We can flip over to VS Code and we can see we have our new lock file. So we have both of them side by side, and what we can do is very easily compare these. Compare selected, and we can see here the differences between them. Now, this is really nice because we can see what's changing through the transitive dependencies. If you look at our Conan file, we're not specifying FMT or ASIO as dependencies. So this is a really easy way to see the consequences of those changes to our entire revision graph. And we know we didn't just update two requirements, we updated four requirements. So we have the speed log going up to 1.12, which is the latest, and Restinio is going up to 0.619. But we also have FMT. FMT jumped two major versions since the last time we ran this, and ASIO has had six minor releases since then. And here we can see them side by side very easily. Now, we can also merge these. Now, you might be wondering, why do you want to merge them and not just use the new one? And it's because if we know we had a good version in the past, why not keep them? So to merge them, we can do Conan lock merge. We're going to specify our original lock file. We're going to specify our new lock file. And we're going to make another one called a new Conan lock file. Again, I'm doing this more verbose than you need to, and it's because I want to demonstrate some of these cool features that it has. So we have our new lock file, and if we come here, you can see this here, and you can see it includes both versions of ASIO, both versions of FMT, both Restinios, and both speed logs. And what's going to happen now is with our version requirements, it's actually going to go through and pick the best version to match our version ranges. So if we were to add another dependency that needed a different version of FMT, let's say that library only had support for FMT 8 to 9 and didn't support 10. Well, then in our graph resolve, we could actually pick that older version of FMT still and still be correct. And I think that has some really nice advantages. So we are going to keep it this way. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rerun our command, but this time I'm only going to output the conan.lock. Means I can come in here, I can delete the new and new, and we only have our default one. And this is the lock file we're going to check into source code as you would with any other package manager, which really makes it easy to work with. Now, with that being done, we can do our Conan install one more time. And we don't need to specify any of these arguments. It's simply going to go and find them in our cache. We already had all the packages because Conan lock had done that. And we're going to just simply be able to get up and running with lock files. Now, at the beginning, I set our goal as grading ourselves and setting our criteria based on the README. So let's take some time and make sure we update our documentation such that the rest of our team can use it. Now, the first case where we have our Conan lock file is this extra prepare Conan step. And this is a consequence of the base lock file. You notice here, our input lock file was a different one than our output. Now, we don't need this at all because our lock file is going to be a full one for 2.0, and it's only going to be the default, right? So we don't need to specify lock file here. Now, another bonus of the Conan 2.0 migration is we don't have any extra legacy temporary files being spewed out by the client, so we don't need a build folder to be specified. And this to me is a lot easier than this. And this is a huge one. So we're gonna delete these and delete these. So now our setup step for Conan went from being two calls with base lock files to full lock files. All of that is gone. And we're simply just going to do Conan install with our Conan file. We also had documentation for using Ninja. I absolutely enjoy working with Ninja, so I think that's fantastic. We're gonna change, again, we're not gonna need this extra lock grid. This notion is gone. And because we're using it in the default path, all we have to do is say, here's the version and these are the profiles you need to use. And we can see that pattern repeating for debug. And if we go down to our updating dependencies, notice here it said Conan lock create before with the update argument that we specified. The reason I did not do it this way and I used Conan install was because explicitly there's a bug currently in 2.0.10 that's already fixed and ready for 2.0.11. It's just not out yet. So unfortunately, I couldn't use that. So for now, we're going to document the way that works. We're going to do Conan install and we're going to snag this here. And we're going to get rid of the new because realistically, we're only ever just going to update our dependencies and we'll have the diff and git. So it'll be just fine, but like that. So lock dependency graph, this step gone. Thank you for 2.0. Now, when we call Conan create, our lock file is always going to be the default path. So we don't need to specify build. We could leave this to be explicitly clear. But I think this is an expectation, especially if you're used to doing DevOps and other package ecosystems, that it's not required. And again, our install, this not required, gone. And I think that's it. So if we do lock file, right, there's far fewer references to lock files. I think that language still works, and I think I'm fine with that. And that's pretty much the one of the few places left. So here we need to explicitly disable it and output a new one. And we're doing this by doing a Conan install, so I don't think this information is necessary. Boom, one last line. With that being said, let's take a look at our diff and let's see if it's actually better. We created our first lock file. That's amazing. We have here, we now have been able to upgrade to version ranges, and that's a huge win. And lastly, our README and our criteria. So the normal workflow, if you cloned this project for the first time, was you had to prepare Conan, whatever that meant. And instead, it's now a much more condensed Conan install. You don't have to remember to do things with log files. There's no extra steps where you can make a mistake. And I think that's going to give people a heck of a lot better experience. And we can see this pattern of going from two commands to one command throughout. And this is fantastic. We got to save steps. So we're going to be able to go when we update our CI/CD pipeline, our GitHub Actions workflow, we're going to be able to remove steps as well, which is great. I'm pretty happy with this. I think this here is the crux of it. And I'm gonna chalk this up as a win for Conan 2.0. Making lock files better. So we're gonna save this. Adding our first 2.0 lock file. Commit. Thank you very much for joining and checking this out. I'm really curious what you think. So if you think this is actually a genuine improvement, hit the like button for me. And if you have deeper comments, thoughts, please feel free to share them. The comments section, you can reach out on social media. And that's a really fantastic thing. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you learned a few things. And cheers.